You are translating something which is not there. Yes. So, that is thieving instinct on the physical plane. But there is thieving instinct on the mental plane. If I look to it, many times while lecturing, I am looking down to my collar. I find this mic something strange. I am thinking, what if I take it away? Of course, I do not take it away. I will return it safely. But all the while thinking, it is better if I have this with me. That is called thieving instincts on the mental plane. I am not courageous to take away the physical things, but mentally I may be stealing many things, 100 things a day, which is more dangerous and more contagious to the person proper. And there is also thieving instincts on the intellectual plane. That is more detrimental. If in my conversations with my friend Robert, I find some fine phrases and sentences, and if they are fascinating, I go to India and use those sentences wonderfully among the audience, and the audience shout, "Oh, very good." I put a face as if the sentences were my own. Like that, we many times copy from the books of others and publish them as our own passages. That is what is called plagiarism. It is thieving instincts on the intellectual and the cultural plane. They are very, very, very detrimental to the person who has them. So, we should try to eliminate all those things in our motives. And the next thing is purity of sex. In a society where this type of yoga practice is possible, to which century the society may belong, it is prescribed that the person should be a celibate up to 21 years and not a celibate by compulsion, but a celibate because his mind is engaged in something which is very attractive on the spiritual plane. And then he should be married, and then after 28th year he should start his sex life, and after middle age, that is 45 years, the husband and wife should grow passive of sex, not fighting with sex are trying to oppress or suppress or eliminate sex, but to grow passive of sex, because both the husband and wife are involved in something doing for the humanity. They begin to live as friends and companions and brothers. Such a type of life is prescribed. Of course, it may not be totally possible in the 20th century society. We should know our limitations. We should know the spirit of the scientist and try to cooperate with the values prescribed by the scientist. According to our own possibilities, we should grow passive to sex after a certain age, so that our interests in life are engrossed with humanity and spiritualism. This is what is called purity of sex. And the next thing is having no obligation. This is most important. That is, don't place yourself in a position where you are obliged to anyone. What does that mean? Before you receive 100 francs, be sure that you have done work of at least 150 francs to the other person. Be sure that you are not indebted to anyone. But don't have it as a complex. Don't have what is called pious aristocracy in your mind. Be sure that the other person has received more from you than you have received from him, by way of work or help or anything. Then only you are fit to have spiritual progress. Otherwise, your subconscious feels the burden of obligations. It never feels the freedom which is due to itself. So these form the first step called regulation of your character. The second step is called rectification. Yes, the first is yama. No, not necessary. It is teasing to some people. If they are not accustomed or habituated to Sanskrit at all, it will be a burden. The import is better, I think. The second one of the eight steps is rectification. The first is regulation, the second is rectification. In Sanskrit, it is called niyama. The first is called yama, the second is called niyama. That is, to rectify yourself physically and mentally. The first step is cleanliness. Teach the child who is to be a yogi to practice cleanliness from his childhood. Physical cleanliness, that is daily washing his body with water and cleaning properly, and having his hair, mustaches and barb close, crisp. That is what is prescribed by all these masters. And also mental cleanliness. That is, let the boy in the evening understand if he has thought good thoughts or bad thoughts about others. Let the mind be purified with progressive ideas. The second is satisfaction as an attitude. Satisfaction not due to incidents, not due to benefits, not due to events, but satisfaction as your own nature. You can develop it very easily. Be satisfied with what you get. Do some more good work, you will get some more money. But be satisfied with what you get at present. Tomorrow you may get more, and you may try for more. But in the meantime, don't grow nervous. If your friend is getting $1,000 more, don't worry. Cut your coat according to the cloth, according to the availability of the cloth. That is how we have to practice. Because what is due to us from the society is a ratio between the society and ourselves. It has got a mysterious ratio which we can never understand. Our logic and our economics will never count it, calculate it. We may calculate some more from the society to us. But what is due to us, according to the merit of not only what we work, but also what we think and what we believe about others. The total, the LCM will be the ratio between us and the society. Sometimes we may not be able to calculate it properly, but live ungrudgingly. Don't grudge against the society. That is, don't grumble or complain against the society. Remember, the society is only individuals like you. There is nothing like society separate from individuals. They are also as good as yourself and as bad as yourself. So, satisfaction should be inevitably practiced by a yogi. Then, previously, he has given what is called austerity and reading the scriptures, because here he is giving the whole thing in a list. He is adding the previous things also in the list, and then total surrender. That is uttering Om and listening to it. These five items will rectify your existence. This is called the second item, rectification. Now we go to the third item according to Patanjali. Third item is practice stability in happiness. We will have happiness only instantaneously, as a flash normally. What we call happiness exists only instantaneously. All the remaining is something before happiness and something after happiness. When something is very tasty to eat, the happiness or the taste is while we are tasting. It is not there while we are preparing. It is not there while we are cleaning the plate. In anything you do, happiness is only a lightning and a flash, before which there is much work, and after which there is much work. It is like the feats in a circus, the items in a circus. For every item, they have to do something in the beginning, and after the item is finished, they have to dismantle many things once again. So there is much preparation and much disposal. In the middle, there is an instantaneous flash of what we call happiness. But all this put together we call happiness, because we are essentially foolish. But here he asks us to practice stability in happiness. You should make the mind live in happiness stably, continuously. How? Sit in a comfortable posture. Select a place which you need not change frequently. Keep the place clean and make the room pleasant. Let it be well ventilated, not only of light but also of air. And then make a place for yourself, the place which you need not change frequently. Select a posture which is comfortable to your age, physical condition and stage of life. And then you sit in that posture. Any posture except lying flat is recommended, because when we lie flat horizontally and begin to practice stability in happiness, we will not be there to enjoy the happiness, because we will go into sleep. In the meanwhile, happiness will be there, and we will awaken when happiness has gone away once again. Every day happiness visits us, but we are not there when happiness is there in our house. That is what happens if we select a horizontal posture. Select a vertical posture. Let your vertebral column be perpendicular to your floor. And the most convenient is called Siddhasana. And you close your eyes and then begin to practice. What? It is called the relaxation of every nerve and every muscle in your body. Mentally, begin to travel from your head to your foot slowly. First of all, observe if any muscles or nerves are in tension in your head. Mentally, remove the tension and relax the muscles and nerves. Then travel to the eyes. Release if there is tension in your eyelids. And when they ask us to close our eyes and sit down, some people sit with very strongly closed eyes, so that there will be a tension in the eyelids. Remove the tension in the muscles of the eyelids, then to the nose, then to the mouth and chin, like that up to the feet. this is the first step you have to take. And then for a few moments, relax the mind completely into your respiration. And then once again, make a tension of every muscle and nerve for about a few seconds. And then relax again, once again, step by step. Like this, alternate a few seconds tension and a few minutes relaxation. A few seconds tension, a few minutes relaxation. By doing so, you are communicating with one of the cosmic principles, what is called the law of pulsation. The space is expanding and contracting alternately, and the space is pulsating. As a result of which, the solar systems are coming out and getting absorbed into the space again. Each solar system is respiring or pulsating, and each atom is pulsating in its nucleus, and each living being is pulsating in the form of respiration and heartbeat. So pulsation is a cosmic law and a cosmic principle, which includes contraction and expansion. Begin to play music in tune with it. That is the next practice you have to do. And then begin to observe the movements of your respiration. Then the mind gradually begins to approach the place where the respiration is taking place. Respiration is energy, and mind gradually approaches the energy center. After certain time, the two become one. There will be no two items. There will be no mind separately, no respiration separately. There will be only one item existing. Then you will experience what is stability in happiness. This is called the third one. This is called asana in yoga pyasa. This step, this process is called asana. But unfortunately, this word is translated in a wrong way. It is understood as the many physical postures and acrobats we do. For example, Sirshasana, head down posture, and Sarvangasana, like an inverted comma, and Halasana, or the plow posture, and Dhanurasana, the bow posture, the bow. Yes, the Sagittarius. So, the many asanas, 100 or 200 or 300, it is not the asana which Patanjali called. The physical asanas come into the first called Yama. You are expected to select your own physical exercise, not according to the lesson in the book, but according to your constitution and need. Let an expert in yoga advise you about your asanas. Let not everyone exhaust the total list of asanas. For example, if a person having hypertension begins yoga, he should not be allowed to do the head down posture. Some people should not do some postures. For some people, little number of asanas are enough. For some people, many asanas are required. It depends upon the constitution. What happens if the guru asks his disciples that all of them should wear the shoes with the dimensions of the guru? Same thing happens if the same list of asanas are prescribed to everyone. So, in the first item, everyone should select the physical exercise required for himself. Now here, what is called asana is stability in happiness. That is what Patanjali says and what Bhagavad Gita says. Immediate effect of this practice is you are making alternations of contraction and expansion in pulsation. The result is the mind is freed from pairs of opposites. That is, the mind is free from receiving a shock in changed conditions. When it is cold now, and when it is very hot tomorrow at noon, the body, it won't receive any shock. If you honor me very much here, tomorrow if someone calls me a fool, it makes no shock to the mind. So, if I am asked to enjoy a big hall throughout the night, and tomorrow somewhere else, if I am asked to stay in a little room where it is not possible to stretch completely, the mind receives no shock. That is possible only by this practice. The circumstances in life, in the family conditions, in the vocational conditions, in the economic conditions, they never create any shock to your mind. So it makes you above and beyond shock. A beautiful shock-proof existence. This is what is called asana, the third step. Then the fourth step, regulating your pulsations. Remember, daily you are asked to sit down and practice something, the contraction and expansion. Now the next step, observe your respiration. There is automatically a contraction and expansion of your lungs. You are not doing it, but the inner you are doing it. The Lord is doing it, not the negative fellow doing it. And begin to observe and enjoy it, and try to cooperate with it. Establish a music, a beat, a rhythm in your respiration. Begin to inhale slowly in a soft, prolonged way, a very smooth way, with uniform speed. Inhale like that, as long as you can inhale conveniently, and then begin to exhale exactly in the same way, slow, soft, uniform, in such an artistic and skillful way that you do not listen the sound of your respiration at all. Again, begin to breathe like that. But no kumbhaka business is here. Patanjali has never prescribed any kumbhaka. And for the consequences of our doing kumbhaka, Patanjali is not responsible. So, if you begin to practice this, at the same time, observing the movements of your respiration with your mind. That is the most important part of it. If you do it without observing this, when your mind is wandering somewhere else, even you do it for 30 years, it is useless. It is like the motor car lifted on jockeys. Better not to know. Say, for your information, you should promise me that you won't do it. See, after receiving it, you are asked to block it for some time. Self-smothering. Okay. That is called kumbhaka technically, which is not described either in Patanjali or Bhagavad Gita. So, when you do this practice, you be observing the movements of your lungs. Question yourself, who is making the movement? You will receive the answer, the I am in you. I am doing it. And then do it for 5 minutes. And then while inhaling, you mentally think of a sound so. While exhaling, you mentally think of the sound hum. As long as you are inhaling, mentally think of so, like that. And when you begin to exhale, mentally think of hum. Until you complete it. Do it for 5 minutes. And next, the third 5 minutes, you leave off the consonants and select the nasal and the vowel. The sound om is left there. The next 5 minutes, that is third set, third 5 minutes, you mentally think of om as long as you are inhaling. And vocally utter om as long as you are exhaling. That is, while you are inhaling, mentally utter om continuously. While you are exhaling, vocally utter om continuously as long as you exhale. At the same time, listen to it completely and continuously. While uttering om, you should listen to your own om. This is what is called the practice of pranayama. Then what happens is, the music or the rhythm in your respiration is re-established. It was there in your childhood, but it has been disturbed 1,000 times a day while you are becoming an elder. Whenever you are angry, it is disturbed. Whenever you are jealous, it is disturbed. Whenever you are afraid of something, it is disturbed. Whenever you are anxious of catching a train or a plane, it is disturbed. Not less than 1,000 times in the day, we disturbed it. According to the law of habit formation, the disturbance has established as a habit in us, and the result is cardiac disturbances, missing beats of the heart, and unequal respiration. So, as we have grown as into adult age, we lost the rhythm and the music in our respiration. Now we can re-establish it by practicing this. Then, after some months of practice, automatically the respiration stops. Don't be afraid, you will be living. But the respiration stops for some time. As long as the mind is one with the function of respiration, the respiration stops. When the mind is once again different from your respiration, again it begins to respire. Don't enforce this stopping of respiration. You are not the maker. The Lord in you, He knows better than you. Let Him do it. And it is possible only when you establish a regularity in your daily routine. See, imagine you are 24 hours like a clock. Have 1, 2, 3, or 4 items in the daily routine established regularly at the same time daily. And you have established a polygon of your routine. Keep up the polygon. Gradually add one more item